Welcome to the Railworld.
I'm officially halfway through my journey and I'm so grateful that everyone thus far has had their arms wide open to my visits. And like I've been told once, never build walls around your heart, because instead of guarding yourself in a comfort zone, you're actually keeping the world at a distance.
So if you're wondering why I'm back on a train in KL, well, the reason being is we went to Aral, and that's pretty much as far as you can get by train. I mean, we walked over the border to Thailand, to Satun. We did a little bit of shopping, went to the market, fantastic stuff. But I had to come back down to KL and jump on the first train to Tampin. Now, Tampin is the closest stop to Malacca, and it takes about 2 hours. So, me having a nice little bed here, might as well make use of it.
When we were all young, we impatiently yearned for the stage of adulthood. We scored distinctions, we rebelled, we got a job, we did anything to prove that we were self-sufficient. Only as we grew older, we realized that guidance and parenthood is actually rather essential. Consequently, the same applies to the birth of our nation. Our forefathers fought the good fight and ultimately reached the point of maturity where independence was bestowed to us on the 31st of August in 1957. Malacca is referred to as the historical state amongst the locals, and it's even listed as UNESCO World Heritage Site since the 7th of July 2008. So stick with me and I'll show you why.
Malacca's past is pretty prominent here in Ujung Pasir. Now, with the intermarriages between the Portuguese settlers and the local women, it brought about a brand new culture. Now, I'm going to meet with my friend Steve, and he's going to take me into his house. He's going to teach me a bit about the Portuguese culture, and he's going to open my taste buds to some fantastic delicacies, and maybe perhaps teach me a word or two in Portuguese.
Although the Portuguese ruled Malacca from 1511 until 1641, I can happily say that now the broken bridges have been rebuilt.
Hey, Henry, buddy!
How's it going, man? This is my cousin John.
John, great. So what have we got in store?
Okay, well, we've got food, tons of it. We've got a few dishes. Awesome. I'm sure you've heard of curry devil, right?
Yes, and I've prepared myself. I put the toilet paper in the fridge, as you instructed.
Okay.
Let's get started.
All right.
John Paul.
Henry, John Paul.
Yeah, this is the kind of welcome I want.
I like this family already.
Hello.
Ooh, I can never say no to home-cooked food.
Wow. Now, please explain. You can see all the chili season. I'm a bit worried.
but you've got the toilet paper.
We've got a whole jug here. This is my cup.
That's right. This is the same art, which is generally it's made from different kinds, another type of meat.
Yep.
But this one's made from dried fish.
This one is his favorite.
Yeah. This is what I come down to eat.
Okay. Excellent. This is the devil.
This is devil curry. That's right.
What a name. Who came up with that? My gosh.
Actually, it's called curry devil.
Curry devil.
Devil.
Okay. Oh, devil.
Devil. But when outsiders come here, they eat, so they sweat, so, this is curry devil.
That's
so it became
it
famous
about.
As curry devil.
Time to fill up my plate. It's time for my taste buds to do all the talking.
A little bit of sauce. Not too much.
This is Portuguese style baked fish.
Portuguese style baked fish. So this is the...
Some more.
Now, I'll have some of this on my rice, because I know it won't be too bad, right?
No, it's just sort of to subside the taste of all the chili.
Okay.
Dip it also.
Straight into that.
You should try it.
Ready?
Now itself, yeah. What do you think?
Mmm. You know, it's... You can taste that shrimp,
yeah.
But the sauce is really, it's much sweeter. You lie, it's not too bad.
Family meals are the one thing that we should all never grow out of.
Before every wedding, they have to have this the night before they get married.
I'm not getting married tomorrow, but I hope not. Not that I know of.
Well, if you meet someone along the way,
yeah,
the settlement, you never know.
Got any Portuguese girls?
Now, I definitely know who I'm going to be hiring at my wedding. I'm excellent at eating, but let's see how well I do with the local Kristang language.
Which are the simple stuff like kumi, eat.
I'd say it's delicious.
Delicious. Oh, that's a good one.
Sabroso.
You sound Italian.
Sabroso.
It's quite hard for me to feel homesick when everyone is treating me like family. This is great. To help with the digestion, we took a quick walk around the settlement.
We're going right now is the Portuguese Square.
Okay.
And normally during like Christmas or even St. Pedro, for example, which is a fisherman's festival,
yeah.
This whole place is like fully decorated. There's like shops and carnivals and stuff like
so
that.
So Christmas is the main
one of the main ones, yeah.
The main event, yeah.
And in fact, the square is also used for Water Day, for example.
Yes.
It's another really
intrudu.
Big...
We call it intrudu. Intrudu. The Thai sort of water festival.
Something like that, yes.
It's a bit like that. So you just sort of
throw water.
Bombard people with water. Yeah.
And there'll be music happening.
Yes. Even in KL, Penang, they will come back for the event.
And then Steve led me to the oldest house here, which was built in 1940.
Well, what you see here right now, it's basically tar. Yeah. And traditionally, I mean originally rather,
it was sand. Yeah. Sea sand, you know, the last
sea sand.
Yeah.
It has since been restored and upgraded and now serves as a unique heritage of the Portuguese community. I think I kind of grew a little attached to Steve's family, so I decided to look around until nighttime. Plus, he said there's loads for me to see here.
So this is the infamous Junkers Walk night market, man. And how often is this on?
Well, it's on every night. What you get here normally is a lot of art stuff. You get like wire art, even wooden art, things like even...
traditional Chinese stuff.
Oh, no thank you. Just looking.
Okay, this is the traditional Chinese shoe.
Oh, these ones?
Used
most wood.
Common used by the Nyonya Babas.
Oh, okay. They're a bit like clogs.
When you walk, they will make some tick-tock.
They're kind of like those Japanese...
They're
clogs, basically, yeah. Fried ice cream. Have you ever tried that before?
Fried ice cream.
Right.
Deep just the fried. Thought of that, it's a bit contradictory.
Is it tasty?
Yeah.
Well, let's go find some, yeah?
All right. It's just in front.
But before we got to that, I got distracted by Yao Chao Koi, Gula Katuk, fried carrot cake. My nostrils are so confused.
So this is the notorious fried egg ice cream, right?
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
Three.
Ooh. So the ice cream is inside the
white. As you can see, it's the coat that actually keeps the ice cream inside intact.
So is it quite crispy when it comes out?
It is, actually. Yeah.
But then inside is melted or is it still ice
cream? It's still ice cream. Ice cream.
Really?
Yeah.
That looks so healthy. Ice cream and oil. All unhealthy things are pretty, you know, they're good for the soul rather than
look at Steve.
He loves.
I love food.
With more mixed cultures comes more diverse types of food.
Ta-da.
Thank you.
The hot.
What do you think, man?
Oh, wow.
That's good stuff, right?
Wow. Nice. I mean, it's like mouth-scorchingly hot.
Hot and
like,
cold.
But the ice cream is like just perfect, right?
Very nice.
Thank you so much.
Looks like Steve was right. There is so much for me to see here. Ooh, check out that man's coconuts.
Alright, that's it, man. That's the end of Junker Walk.
That was fantastic, guys. I'm pretty much usually spending a lot of money in these places, but I managed to withhold myself.
Yeah, exactly. The really good thing about Junker Walk is the fact that you can get really good bargains here.
Yeah.
So if you're ever down here, again in Malacca, one thing to do, drop by here. I'll be
looking at you guys.
Oh, no
John,
no
thank
no
you so
no
much, mate. Hopefully see you soon.
Henry.
Always a pleasure.
Bro. Take it easy.
All right.
See you later.
Ciao, man.
Now, the Portuguese weren't the only settlers in Malacca. They were also the Peranakan. Now, Peranakan is directly translated as descendants. Now, they were the Chinese mainlanders who came over to Malacca, and they adapted and they married into the Malaysian culture. So I'm going to meet with Bibek, who's going to teach me a little bit about the history. Bibek! Hello!
If you're an avid Malaysian TV watcher in the 80s, you'll definitely recognize her.
Wow, look at that. How stunning is this?
Yes, this is a true Baba Nyonya house. This is all over 100 years old.
Whoa.
And brought in from China.
Wow, they're big, aren't they? I didn't realize how they look quite small from the outside.
Yes, of course. These houses are Dutch houses, Dutch style. And why it is narrow and very long?
Yeah,
you can... Because last time the Dutch style did the quick rent. is assessed through the width of the house.
So they cheated.
They made the house very narrow, so that they paid less tax, but the length was very long.
The economic turmoil in China was the leading cause behind the flooding of the Chinese immigrants to Malacca. With the birth of Peranakan, most of the ethnic and religious origins were retained from China, whereas the language, outfits and food were derived more from the Malay side.
Ah, this is what I like. I mean, this is an airwell.
Airwell, that's it. It's called a chin-chin. Last time, in the olden day, there was no electricity. So we depend on natural light.
Yeah.
So this is a place where children will play their games. Five stones, as chongkak, you know?
Then Bibik taught me another well-known Baba Nyonya game called Injuk Injie Semut.
So you go all
until you get red arms.
You forget, this is supposed to be like the ants biting you. So it's painful, you go on top. Until finally, if you forget to go on top, then you're penalized. So you can play many, many people.
You probably beat me. I mean, you look as if you've got some nimble hands there.
Okay, now we go to the back. There's the kitchen near the back there.
This is a pestle and mortar. I think that's the biggest pestle and mortar I've ever seen.
For belacan. Now it's all in a blender. Although it takes you 2 minutes. Last time it takes you half an hour.
But the flavor is much more.
But the flavor is different. And even cooking. Like say you use this stove here. We use firewood. And that's why we have a big, huge chimney here for the smoke to go up.
That is a big chimney, actually.
And everything last time, the whole kitchen would be black.
Because of the soot.
Because of the soot, yes.
Interestingly, their usage of crockery is represented in its colour. The colourful reddish ones are used for weddings and joyous occasions, but however, for funerals and ancestral prayers, the blue and white ones are used.
Was that your bike when you were younger?
I don't think you... The ladies are not allowed to ride.
Ladies aren't allowed to ride?
No, these are all...
That's like
children.
Something I would ride my bike on. Wow, Bibik, I've got to thank you so much. It was brief, but I learned so much about the Peranakan history and culture. Thank you so much.
Thank you, you're most welcome. But later, don't forget, please come to Jeta Groves.
Jeta Grove?
Yes.
What are we going to do there?
I'm going to give you some wonderful experience with the Nyonya cuisine.
Oh, that sounds absolutely delicious. I'll take you up on that. That's a date, okay?
Don't forget.
I'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Okay, see you. Enjoy yourself in Malacca.
I will do.
Okay, bye.
So Bibi told me a lot about the Peranakan cultures and histories. It's just made me hungry. So she said, actually, meet us here at Jeta Grooves, and she's going to feed me some of the local Baba and Nyonya delights. Hi, I'm looking for Bibi. Do you know Bibi?
Bibi? Yeah. Yes, she's here.
Yeah?
Bibi.
You?
I'm Bibi.
I should have known.
Okay, I bluffed. I knew already. But who wouldn't have guessed? Kenny was the star of the TV show Baba Dan Nyonya, which had 509 episodes and won the award for the longest running sitcom in Malaysia. Bibik is an absolute veteran.
So what's with dressing up like Bibi?
Oh, actually, in the olden days, the Peranakans are very conservative.
Yeah.
They do not allow women to come on stage to perform.
They
cannot go to the public. So that's why all female roles were taken by men.
How long have you been playing Bibi?
About almost 30 years.
30 years? So Bibi's 30 years old. She's looking great.
Oh! thank you.
Bibi told me all about the historical side. Kenny's turn to show me all about the the Baba and Nyonya food.
If I want to put it down here, I think 4 tables is insufficient.
4 tables?
Yes. But anyway, we'll give you a lighter version.
Okay.
Most famous would be the Peranakan Nyonya Laksa.
There we go, Nyonya Laksa.
And of course the chendol.
Authentic Baba Nyonya chendol has no artificial colouring. Instead, it is made with the crushing of chendol leaves and pandan leaves. While the curry mu uses no curry powder at all, it is blended with 7 different spices. Definitely different from what I'm used to back in KL. Next, I was given the mee siam, also spicy, but added with tamarind water and a squeeze of lime to add its sourness for that extra kick. Lastly, I tried the lontong. It may be mere rice cubes with a bit of coconut milk and spices, but dang, my mouth rejoiced in its excellence.
Now, this is all really pretty traditional food to the Peranakan, sort of culture. But like all traditions in the world, I mean, it's slowly dying out.
Yes.
I mean, the next generation, they're not bothering to keep up the traditions.
Well, I can tell you, the Peranakan culture is also facing the same fate.
Yeah.
So the only thing that we can keep alive for generations to come will be the dressing of the peranakan, the nyonyas, okay, the more tight-fitting, sexy kebayas, sarong, and the food. But of course, many of these dishes, the real authentic one, has been gone. Before I really go, I'm going to introduce those long lost and forgotten dishes. Then at least I have something written down for the generations to come.
And that's what people should be, you know, they should be keeping up to date with, you know, the past and present, but also the future. So I'm thinking of words to describe all this food, but I think the best way to possibly describe it is in the Peranakan language. So you need to teach me how to say delicious at least.
Yeah, and the more colloquial and the more expressive thing you say, shock sekali.
Shock sekali.
This guy is so talented. Not only does he play bibik, but he also does this.
Wow. Very beautiful. Meaning, if you are a girl, any girl, you fall in love with me.
Really?
Yeah. And it stay under the shade of your eyelashes.
Wow.
I can feel my head. That is Hindi.
And that was breathtaking. I think I'm going to take a few Hindi lessons to charm old Ashwarya right into my arms. But you know what? Forget the eyelashes. I think I'd hide under her nostril hairs.
You see, Malacca's a bit of a double-edged sword. I mean, there's so much to see historically. The buildings are beautiful. And the thing is, it's a little too far to walk around, yet it's pretty pointless to take a car. So I mean, the best mode of transport is one of these babies, a trishaw. So I'm gonna have a quick tour around Malacca. Who's the owner of this beautiful little thing? Is this yours?
Yes. Yeah.
Are you free to give me a tour?
Yes, you can.
Ah, perfect. That's all right. Let's just jump in and whisk ourselves away.
Yeah. That was it.
All right.
So how long have you been driving your trishaw for?
I'm junior. I'm
a junior.
3 years three years ready.
3 years is only junior. Wow.
Even though he says he's a newbie, he has a vast knowledge on this town. So I guess this will be my Malacca history lesson on a trishaw.
Wow, check that out.
It's very nice.
Brava. It's a big boat.
Yeah.
Lesson number one, how Malacca originated.
First, we are give you a story about this tree.
Okay. Oh, this tree?
Yes. Okay, 14th century, starting Malacca, okay? The Parameswara king, they find the tree where the dog fighting with the moose down under the tree. They ask Malay people, hey, what's the name of this tree? And then the Malay people say for him, it's a Malacca tree.
Ah, so that's the story of how Malacca became Malacca.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, you know what? I'm itching to get over there. So should we walk over there?
We see the
All right.
Lesson number two, the building that you can never ignore, the A Formosa.
So this is a Dutch fort.
This is a Portuguese fort.
A Portuguese fort.
Rainy back from Dutch. In front, you can see in front is from Dutch.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then when the Portuguese come Malacca, they bring the Christian at Malaysia.
Oh, so they put Christianity to Malaysia.
Yes, that is the first church in Malaysia. They call the St. Paul Church.
And that land was later turned into a burial ground by the Dutch for their noble dead. But be it original ruins or rebuilt structure, both these buildings are of important value to the Malacca heritage.
14th century is the beginning Malacca. Malacca, we got Sultan.
Yeah.
And then when 1511, Portuguese come Malacca, they boom, they're fighting to get Malacca.
Yeah.
That's why they boom. And then when 1511, Malacca king run away under the state until Malacca. No more come here.
Because Malacca was one of the center of the spice trade. So everybody wanted this location because the Strait of Malacca was pretty much the gateway to the rest of the world.
Yeah.
On the way back, I spotted something that was very familiar to me. Choo-choo.
What are they doing here in Malacca?
This is the first model tree in our Malaysia.
Yeah.
Now they're put for the history.
Huh?
They put Malacca for people. No, this is the first model tree in our Malaysia, 1957.
Right here.
Oddly enough, there still isn't a train station that stops directly in Malacca town. There were once railway tracks before World War II, but they were dismantled by the Japanese during the war, and it was never rebuilt.
Bangga, dua orang? Boleh? Alright.
Don't worry, saya belanja for you, abang.
Terima kasih. You know what? This actually looks pretty cool. Is it hard work?
Yes.
It's hard work?
Hard work.
Do you think I can try?
Yes, if you can try.
Let's have a go.
And now it's time for me to return the favor.
Fine, sir. Have a seat.
Be careful.
Where are we going to? Where would you like to go, young man?
Now you want to go Dutch building.
Let's go to the Dutch building?
Yeah.
I'll take you to the Dutch building. No worries. Ooh, very high, huh? Onwards!
Looks like I got myself some train fare.
Welcome to the rail world!
So the perfect way to wind down an excellent day. You know, I was in Malacca, Bibek showed me about the Peranakan history and the cultures, whilst Kenny fed me some of the Peranakan delicacies. But now dusk is setting and I've made my way over to Muara Sungai Duyung. As you can see, a lot of fishing villages, which means fish. My perfect and most delicious dish ever. We're gonna go for ikan bakar.
And directly translated, this place would be called the Mermaid Estuary.
This is the perfect time to be out by the seaside. We've got kingfishers near the river. We've got the birds flying out into the sunset. Check that out. What more could you ask for? So here at Muara Sungai Duyung, we've got all the sort of today's catches. Really, you know, there's even a sign saying that it's freshly caught, packed in ice, and then brought straight here. So we're gonna go for a fish called jenna. So to check if it's all fresh, check underneath the gill, it's nice and red. Perfect. These just came out, so a couple of these babies. Now, looking at the size of these guys, I mean, huge. Now, you can almost guess what's inside this black liquid right here. Nothing, it's empty.
But I must have my sotong.
Sotong,
all right, there we go. Okay, my seafood buffet.
The waiting period is always the hardest, and it doesn't make things easier to see all these people happily stuffing their faces while my seafood is still in the cooking pot.
So one of the benefits of actually living in Malaysia is Malaysia's a peninsula. Pretty much all of the country is surrounded by sea, and where there's sea, it fruits beautiful food like this.
A random speciality here would be that they serve you a small yet delicious packet of nasi lemak to be eaten with your dishes.
You can pretty much tell by the look of things, it's all absolutely delicious. I mean, the sea's right there, the restaurant's right here. So any fool can see that the fish and the seafood is absolutely fresh as you can get it.
Look out for next week's Welcome to the Rail World as I'll be entering the largest state of Malaysia, and that's Pahang.
There we go.
Right, no, and.
One, two, three, four.